Hello, and welcome to the Community IT Innovators Technology Topics Podcast, where we discuss nonprofit technology, cybersecurity, tech project implementation, strategic planning, and nonprofit IT careers. Find us at communityit.com. Thank you for joining Community IT for this podcast, Part 1. Subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts and leave us a rating to help others find this leadership resource for nonprofits. Listen for Part 2 in your podcast feed.
Welcome, everyone, to the Community IT Innovators webinar, Creating Value and Saving Money on Nonprofit Tech. I want to thank you all for coming and thank Nonprofit Learning Lab for hosting us. And I'm going to jump right into our learning objectives. So all of these topics contribute to your ability to get the most value you can out of your nonprofit IT at your organization. So after today, we hope that you will have learned the role IT can play in the success of your nonprofit as you grow. You can understand in general when to outsource, when to build talent in-house, when to hire. You can learn what IT is needed at different sizes and stages of growth, and you can be familiar with typical IT job descriptions and roles at nonprofits. We know many people who are responsible for IT at a nonprofit aren't necessarily IT experts, and we don't actually think that you need to be an IT expert to manage IT as a function of your business, just like you don't have to be an architect to be able to manage an office. Sometimes IT can seem really bewildering to manage, and there's a lot of anxiety around it. So today we're going to talk about well-managed IT and how IT can create opportunities for your nonprofit to grow and thrive. I'm very happy today to introduce the CEO of Community IT, Johan Hammerström. Johan, can you tell us a little bit more about your background in nonprofit IT?
Yeah, thank you, Carolyn, and good morning to everyone. Thank you for joining us today, or good afternoon, depending on where you're joining us from. My name is Johan Hammerström. I'm the CEO at Community IT. I've been in the nonprofit tech space for almost 25 years and helping nonprofits use technology to accomplish their mission. We at Community IT have learned a lot about nonprofit technology over the years and really excited to share some of what we've learned with you all today.
Thanks, Johan. My name is Carolyn Woodard. I'm the Outreach Director for Community IT, and I'll be helping moderate today. And before I came to work at Community IT, I worked in nonprofit management from small to large organizations, and I was an IT director, but I'm not an IT person. So anyone can pretty much tell you. I think Johan will second that. So having been a client and now with an outsourced IT provider, I'm really looking forward to sharing some of our ideas and best practices with you today. But before we begin, if you're not familiar with Community IT, a little bit about us. We are 100% employee-owned managed service provider. We provide outsourced IT support. We work exclusively with nonprofit organizations, and our mission is to help nonprofits accomplish their missions through the effective use of technology. We are big fans of what well-managed IT can do for your nonprofit. We serve nonprofits across the United States, and we've been doing this for over 20 years. We are technology experts, and we are consistently given the MSP 501 recognition for being a top MSP, which is an honor we received again in 2022. We are not fans of IT providers who use a lot of lingo or tell clients that the IT is just too complicated for them to understand. We are IT experts, so you don't have to be, but we firmly believe in partnering with clients so that they can understand the risks, opportunities, and IT management goals for their own organization. So we are going to start out this presentation with a poll. Johan, would you read the options to the audience?
Yep. Yeah. So the options are, is your organization between 1 and 10 staff, between 11 and 25, between 26 and 100, or over 100 staff, or does this question not apply to you? And we found that the size of an organization can make a big difference in how the organization uses technology and the kinds of things a nonprofit needs to do to get the most out of its technology. So there are other important factors too, like the maturity of the organization, how long it's been operating, but the size, and especially in these size ranges, really makes a, plays a big role in sort of the way in which one should effectively manage technology. So we always like to get a sense of where the audience is at and try to tune our presentation a little bit towards the results of the poll.
Excellent. All right, so I'm going to read the results. About 42% were in the 1 to 10 size of staff, 8% in the 11 to 25, 33%, about a third in that 26 to 100 tier, 17% are at organizations that are over 100 staff members, and we didn't have anyone that this didn't apply to. So, and we are going to follow up this poll with a second poll. And this one, Johan, I think, can you read the options?
Yep. Yeah. And so in addition to size, one of the other factors that really contributes to how nonprofits manage their IT is how they're using the IT and the extent to which technology is integrated into and critical for the programmatic work and the accomplishing of the mission. So we've got five options here. The first option is just basic office support. You have IT for the very basic purposes of sending emails, printing reports, maybe checking websites. But beyond that, you're not using technology in any more advanced fashion. The second option is what we call basic office support plus, where in addition to just those basic office automation tools, you're also using some business critical platforms, maybe a CRM, to track constituents and donors. Maybe you have a case management or other type of programmatic database for delivering your program. You're using your financial software and maybe slightly more advanced ways. So that's the second option. The third is you're using IT to deliver services. So it's not just that you're tracking your programmatic work with technology, but you're actually delivering technology as part of your programmatic work. Classic example of that would be a school that's using technology and educational technology in particular as part of its instructional mission. So that's the third. And then the fourth, which we're starting to see more and more of in the nonprofit space, are nonprofits that are using technology in a disruptive way. So we've started to work with a number of nonprofit organizations that are actually building apps. They're building apps, they're collecting data. They're essentially, they're almost like an IT startup, but they're using technology for a social benefit. So that's kind of the fourth way in which an organization might be using technology. So we'd love to hear from you. And then fifth is none of this applies to you. Hopefully, based on the results from the previous poll, you see yourself in one of these four categories, and we'd love to find out a little bit more about the audience today and where you're coming from in terms of your use of IT.
I'm going to read off the results. So for basic office support, really just doing the bare bones of supporting email primarily, we had 21% in that category. Basic office support plus, about 36%. And about 36% also said they deliver services using IT. 7% said they are at an organization that uses IT in innovative ways. And again, we didn't have anyone that this is not applicable for. So thank you again so much for filling that out. That looks like a pretty standard bell curve there. So we're going to talk a lot about IT and nonprofit leadership and who's in charge. And then we have a couple other categories here around budgeting for IT, opportunities that IT can give your nonprofit, and then we'll finish up with some challenges. So Johan, do you want to take over?
Yeah, thanks, Carolyn. And I found those poll results really interesting. It seemed pretty evenly split. A third are using sort of the basic office support plus. A third of you are using IT to deliver services. And just under 10% of you are actually using IT in disruptive ways. So, and that's consistent with what we've seen in the work that we do. Nonprofits are using technology in more sophisticated ways. And I know for a long time, people sort of had this assumption that nonprofits were always behind and were Luddites and, you know, we're not keeping up with the times when it came to IT. That's never actually been our experience. We've always found nonprofit organizations to be really interested in how they can use IT more effectively to accomplish their mission. And that's one of the exciting things for us about working in this space is we really get to engage with a lot of different organizations that are interested in how can we use IT more effectively. Obviously, nonprofit organizations are very frugal. They're very mindful of their resources and their resource limitations, and they want to make sure that they're using their hard-earned donations and grant money as effectively as possible and really leveraging that investment in technology to accomplish the mission. So that's something that you're all interested in and part of why you're here on this webinar today. And I think that this first question, you know, how do you manage IT well and how can that play a role in the success of a nonprofit organization is really a fundamental question for a lot of nonprofits. And depending on your role in the organization, you may be a true believer and you may be a key decision maker and you just want to better understand best practices around managing IT well, or you could be someone who's you understand and get the value of managing IT, but maybe some of the other decision makers in the organization don't quite get that value or aren't, you know, ready to make the investment or the commitment to IT that the organization needs. So hopefully, I mean, our goal is to speak to those different contexts. And obviously leadership is key. Leadership has to be on some level supportive of the importance of IT in the organization. And I think as the poll results showed, that is something that's undergone a pretty significant change over the last 10 to 15 years. Even over the last 3 or 4 years, I think the pandemic really really brought home the point that in order to be successful, you have to be using technology successfully. So hopefully, you know, more and more, many of you on the webinar today have supportive leadership. And have leadership that understands and promotes the value of IT. I think it's particularly important for leadership that's non-technical to be supportive of IT. And this is another area where we've seen a real change in the industry. I think there was a time when most leaders would say, I don't know anything about technology, and it's just a big mystery to me. What are we going to do? You know, what can we do about it? And I think increasingly nonprofit leaders and executives recognize that they have some role in ownership of and decision making around IT. And that's really critical for an organization to use IT successfully. Someone at an executive level has to own IT and they have to, you know, delegate that function to either somebody else in the organization or to somebody outside of the organization. But they still need to be aware of the decisions that are being made. So having good reporting structures around IT is critical, and making sure that you have a technical owner that can explain the importance of IT in non-technical terms is also very critical to having effective, well-managed IT. So for larger organizations, that could mean bringing in a director of technology or even a CIO or a CTO. We usually don't see that until the organization gets to at least 50 staff, usually not till they get to 100. 100 is sort of the cutoff in some ways between being able to outsource your IT completely and having to bring some of it in-house.
You just reminded me, I think I remember 15, 20 years ago, there was a program where you would take the executive at the nonprofit and pair them up with like a young person to kind of explain like, how does this Facebook work? And how do I do these other things? And it's good that we're not really seeing that a lot now. It's more expected that executives will have an understanding of what the role IT plays and how business critical it is to them. But I wondered if you could talk a little bit more about kind of budgeting. You talked a little bit earlier about how nonprofits tend to be frugal. And so can you talk a little bit about the issues with budgeting for IT?
Sure. Yeah. So budgeting for IT is, and that's really the point at which the organization makes a commitment to IT is what they put in their budget to fund IT. And many of the conversations that happen between the IT department and the non-technical IT leadership happen around the budget. You know, what's this going to cost? How much are we going to have to invest in it? That's really where the rubber hits the road. And so that's, you know, having being able to explain the need for, you know, investment in IT in a way that aligns with the business needs and the strategic needs of the organization is really critical. And thinking about understanding like what the value of IT is to the organization really helps with how to frame the budget. So for, you know, the organizations that are in the first two categories from our poll question, you know, the basic office support categories, IT is really going to be more of a cost center. So similar to your facilities costs, similar to your insurance costs, you know, risk mitigation. Those are things that you have to have, but they're cost centers. They're not necessarily directly, you know, benefiting the mission of the organization. But organizations that are more, you know, using IT to deliver services or even being disruptive with IT, for those types of organizations, it's going to be more of a value add. And so you can, you need to be able to talk about how IT is going to enable the organization to accomplish its mission more effectively. And you can see, you can tie IT initiatives to programmatic initiatives. And so organizations are investing in program delivery. That's why they exist. And that's really a value add for the organization. And in cases where you're using IT and leveraging it to deliver a program, it becomes more of a value add versus a cost center. And you can even, as you're budgeting, you can split up the elements of the budget into those two categories.
I think recently too, though, there are a lot of productivity tools that might cut across that, you know, strict line of where it's advantageous and where it's felt to be more of a just a cost. Because if you have staff who, like, they're on an old monitor, they can barely see it, or you have Office 365, but you're not using the tools that help your staff collaborate with each other, or you've got staff working remotely and they can't all see the same database. So they're like downloading it, working on the spreadsheet, uploading it, all of that sort of thing. I think there you can make another argument for investment.
Yeah, for sure. There is kind of a basic level of investment that has to get made. And I think one of the areas that we see this the most in is with cybersecurity. And insurance is a good, not only a good analogy, but, you know, anyone who's looked at, you know, renewing their cyber liability insurance policy knows exactly what I'm talking about. The landscape has changed dramatically and the costs are going up, but that's because the risks have gone up really dramatically as well. So, you know, there are certain areas where if you don't invest, you're putting the organization at risk, and that could be significant risk, like with cybercrime and other cybersecurity threats, or it could just be, like you're saying, Carolyn, the risk of lost productivity. Another area where we see that is with purchasing equipment for staff, and this was something that really got exacerbated by the pandemic. And there, I think, among a number of nonprofits, there was sort of a tendency to let staff use their own personal computer to do work for the organization. And this creates all kinds of problems and issues. There's no, you know, there's security issues that result, there's data integrity issues, there could be potentially privacy issues. It doesn't ensure that staff have a computer that they can be productive on. So there's a whole host of problems that come from not providing staff with equipment to do their work. And that's an area where you have to do that if you want to have a well-managed IT, you know, in your organization. But there are, obviously, it costs more than having staff, you know, use their own computer. I will say, just quick, there's always two sides to every argument. There are certain cases, you can make a case for staff having their own computer. There are certain special situations where that actually does make sense. But you have to make the business case for it. It can't be, we're doing it to save money. It has to be aligned with how the organization works. And there are certain situations where having staff use their own computers actually makes more sense because of the unique special nature of the work that the organization's doing and because of their mission. But you have to be intentional about that. And you have to recognize there are other costs that you're going to be incurring. So there are no free lunches, you know, so it's always about trade-offs.
You got to plan. You got to plan and be intentional about it, which this talk about inventory is a perfect segue to our next segment, where we're going to talk about IT roadmaps. And so there might be some people who don't know what an IT roadmap is and kind of who does it, how you use it as an organization. So could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, absolutely. So an IT roadmap, it sounds a little fancy. For small organizations that are using IT simply, it really could just be sort of almost like a three-year budget. So for example, like a key element of a roadmap would be the lifecycle replacement plan. So you've got, if you have 12 staff, we recommend replacing laptops every 3 or 4 years. Your roadmap would have listed in it, we're going to replace 3 laptops, you know, every year. That's just part of our roadmap. You may be on an old database for managing your donors. Maybe you have a server, maybe you still have an office with a server in it that is, you know, not really doing anything productive for you anymore, and you want to move out into the cloud. That would go on the roadmap. So the roadmap is a set of initiatives or IT initiatives that are beneficial to the organization. They're motivated usually either by sort of internal technology requirements, like an old server that is out of warranty and is about to crash, needs to be replaced. That's an internal technical requirement. They're also motivated by external strategic needs that the organization has. So you're launching a new program, you got a grant to do a certain kind of work, and you need to collect data and report on that work. You might have to have a new database that would allow you to collect the data and provide the reports to the funder. So that's an externally sort of motivated technology initiative that would also go on the roadmap. And so the roadmap's a list of all of those initiatives. And then it's mapped out over time. So because it's really important to map the initiatives out over time, because you have to recognize that your staff can only handle so much change. And certain things might fit together better in a certain order than in another order. So the funder might need a report by a certain time, so that project has to come first. And maybe that old server isn't really hurting anybody, and it could be, you know, but decommissioning it will impact staff in some way in terms of how they work. So, okay, and also it depends on the culture of the organization. Some organizations, some nonprofits are very fast, they move quickly, they want to get a lot done, and they have staff who can keep up with a rapid pace of change. And other organizations are like, hold on, if you move too fast, everything's going to break and fall apart. So the roadmap really needs to incorporate, you know, the tolerance of the organization for change, and also align with other things. Like, we've got a big conference in September, probably shouldn't roll out our new security training platform at that time. We have end of year reports that have to go out to funders. Okay, let's block out December. We aren't going to do any projects in December. So it's kind of, I mean, it's a fancy term for like a calendar plus a plus a budget or a list of initiatives. And obviously, as you get larger, it becomes more complex, it becomes more sophisticated. You'll use more advanced tools. But for small organizations, it could just be a Word document or a spreadsheet.
Can you make an IT roadmap yourself? Do you have to have a technical background to be able to do it? And kind of what skills and go into being able to understand IT and do this kind of IT management, putting the budget together, a calendar, when you're going to do initiatives?
I would say the larger you get and the more complex the technology becomes, the more likely it is that you'll need someone who's an expert in IT, whether that's a consultant or someone in-house in the organization. I think if you have less than 10 staff, that's kind of the cutoff for us, maybe creeping up to 15. If you have someone who's relatively tech savvy, who you trust to make good tech decisions, you can probably create the roadmap yourself. You can reach out to like N10 has a great forum with a lot of people who are interested in helping. TechSoup has a lot of great resources on their website. So we have great resources on our website as well. So there are definitely resources out there for smaller organizations. I think as you get larger though, and certainly once you hit, you know, that 25 to 30 mark, it would be important to bring in a professional, an IT professional, to at least assist with making the roadmap. For a couple of reasons. I think one, the interconnections between the different technology systems become more complex and sophisticated as an organization gets larger. And so having someone who's just familiar with managing that is pretty important. But then also, if you're looking ahead 5 years, you also need to be mindful of what's changing in the world of technology. And so having an IT professional assisting with the creation of the roadmap would better ensure that the planning that's being done is consistent with where the industry as a whole is going, whether it's related to the cloud, whether it's related to security concerns. And then you can also embed like best practices and industry best practices into your planning. You know, do you need more than just antivirus? How much security training do you need? Do you have MFA, multi-factor authentication? Are you already using it? What about single sign-on? Can you still use LastPass? There are just a lot of sort of detailed questions around the effective use of technology that it's very helpful to have an expert to assist with.
That makes sense. We have a couple of resources on our site. Kind of covers, you have what area it is, the recommendation, the urgency, do I need to do this right away? Can it wait till next year? And so you just would go through and map out these different pieces.
Thank you for joining Community IT for this podcast, part one. Subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts and leave us a rating to help others find this leadership resource for nonprofits. Listen for part two in your podcast feed. Community IT does these free webinars and podcasts for our community, and we love sharing our knowledge and experience. If you have more questions or are having trouble with your IT at your nonprofit, please get in touch with us on our website, www.communityit.com, so we can start a conversation or schedule an assessment. Downloading any of our free resources there will get you signed up for our webinar reminders, and you can attend our next webinar in real time and ask our experts your own questions. If you love podcasts, please subscribe and leave us a rating to help others find this leadership resource for nonprofits.